Hi, my name is Chris and I'm a recovered alcoholic. My sobriety date is Melbourne Cup Day 1995. Thanks for joining us. This is a workshop about the first step of the Alcoholics Anonymous 12-step program. It is a simple illustrated guide put together by two alcoholics. It's based on readings from the Alcoholics Anonymous book and on our own experience.
Hi, my name's David. I'm an alcoholic. The first thing that I got when I started coming to AA a long time ago, back in 1993, was identification. I'd been trying to stop drinking for some time. I drank for 17 years, and the last three of those years, I was desperately trying to stop drinking, and I'd failed multiple detoxes and hospitalisation. And for a long while, I avoided AA, but I ended up in a sort of a halfway house, a dry house, and part of the rules of living there is that I had to go to AA. And as I said, the first thing I got by going to some AA meetings was identification. I listened to people and I heard about why they came to AA, what had been happening in their lives, and I realised I wasn't alone, that there were other people who had the same problems that I did with alcohol. The second thing I got from going to AA meetings was I got some hope, because here were these people who'd been through the same or similar things to me, but lots of them were not drinking and lots of them were happy about not drinking. And that actually gave me some hope. By the time I got to AA, I'd lost all hope. I'd been trying for so long to stop and failing. I'd almost given up trying to give up. And this was really, to me, the first time I'd met people who'd actually recovered. And this was said to me early days, when if you go to an AA meeting, whether it's a workshop like this or any AA meeting online or in person, or when you're talking to other AA members, always look for those two things. I get identification when people talk about their problems with alcohol and I go, yeah, that's what I was like. And always look for hope. Now, I can go to a meeting and meet someone who's 40 years sober and I think maybe I can get to 40 years sober. But I also get hope from new people around. I go to my AA home group and there's someone new and they're feeling pretty sick and sorry for themselves. And then a few weeks later, they keep coming to meetings and they do some of the suggested things. And something changes, and they've got a smile on their face, and they're staying sober, and that rekindles my hope. So there's the recommendation. Always look for those two things, identification and hope. Now, the thing that I identified with is when people talked about the problem, particularly the problem with alcohol, because by the time I got to AA, that's all I had, lots of problems caused by my drinking. And I got hope when they talked about the solution being the AA Fellowship, and in particular, the 12-step program. Now, tonight, because we're talking about the first step, we're really going to concentrate on the problem. I really need to understand what my problem is, otherwise I'm not going to be interested in the solution. So this is the first step of the 12-step program. Step one, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives have become unmanageable. And through this workshop and through the whole series of workshops, it's based on what's written in the AA Big Book. Now, this is the book that was written when the first 100 members got sober back in the 1930s, and it's still used as the basic text today. The first few chapters of this book are really about step one and what alcoholism is. I'm going to pick out some of the readings out of that. This is one of them.
Most of us have been unwilling to admit we're real alcoholics. No person likes to think he's bodily and mentally different from his fellows. Therefore, it is not surprising that our drinking careers have been characterised by countless vain attempts to prove we could drink like other people. The idea that somehow, someday, he will control and enjoy his drinking is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker. The persistence of this illusion is astonishing. Many pursue it into the gates of insanity or death. We learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we're alcoholics. This is the first step in recovery. The delusion that we are like other people, or presently maybe, has to be smashed.
So it's when I fully concede to my innermost self that I'm an alcoholic, that's when I've taken step one. That's the action of step one, is actually conceding to myself, yes, I'm an alcoholic. So I need to know what that means. The thing that interests me about this reading is when it talks about no person likes to think he is bodily and mentally different from his fellows. So it's suggesting that if I'm an alcoholic, I'm different from other people. And when I think about it, that's got to be the case because a lot of people drink alcohol. In fact, the majority of the adult population in Australia drinks alcohol at some point in time, but most of them don't end up with the sort of problems I ended up with. and they don't end up in detoxes and hospitals because of their drinking, and they certainly don't end up in AA. So what's the difference between me and the vast majority of people who drink alcohol? Well, let's have a look at this guy. This guy's a normal drinker, and he's gone out. He's going to have a couple of drinks and enjoy himself, and he has that first drink and feels the effects of that, and a bit later on he's offered another drink and he has another drink, and a bit later on he's offered another drink and he says, no thanks, I've had enough. Because he knows he's got the car in the car park and doesn't want to drive drunk. He knows he has to go to work in the morning and doesn't want to be hungover. But in fact, he probably doesn't even need to think about those things. He's had a couple of drinks, got to a point where he said, that's enough for tonight, and he just stops there. Now, I don't identify with that guy. I identify with this guy. This guy is pretty much the same in every other way, except when he starts drinking. He has the intention of only having one or two, but something different happens. He gets this craving to keep going and keep going. And he forgets about the car in the car park. And he forgets about having to go to work in the morning. He even forgets about the promise that he made to himself. Tonight I'm not going to get drunk. I'm only going to have one or two. Once he starts drinking, he's just got to keep on drinking. This is the guy I identify with. And when I was first around AA, this is the aspect of the illness of alcoholism that I first identified when people talked about this. People said things like, I start with the intention of only having one or two, but then I have to keep going. I get the taste for it. One's too many and a thousand's not enough. Once I start drinking, I don't want to stop. And when I think about it, I'd actually known about this long before I had other problems caused by my drinking. I knew there was something different about my drinking. Even to the extent, I can remember back in my early 20s, working in an office job in the city. And occasionally, it could be Friday lunchtime, someone's birthday, we're celebrating something, but a few of us would go out to lunch to a local restaurant and just for lunch together. And some people would have, say, a Crown Lager with their lunch or a glass of wine. I can remember saying, no, I won't have a drink at lunchtime. Because I knew if I had one or two drinks at lunchtime and had to go back to the office and work, I wouldn't want to work. If I'd had those couple of drinks, I'd have this feeling I'd want to keep on drinking. I'd be feeling uncomfortable. I'd be watching the clock. I'd be hanging out for another drink. So I'd rather say no to the one at lunchtime and wait until 5 o'clock and knock off and go and have a real drink. Now, if you had said to me at the time, have you got a problem with drinking? And I'd say no, I've got a lot of control over alcohol because I can say no to the one at lunchtime. But really the reason I was saying no, even back then, is because I knew that after I'd had that first one, I had very little control. See, that's quite different from my work colleagues. My work colleagues have a couple of drinks, they come back to the office, probably a bit jollier than they otherwise would be because they've had a couple of drinks. But they don't have the same reaction as me. They're not hanging out for another drink. They might go home that night and not have another drink for the rest of the day. So even back then, in my early 20s, I knew there was something different about my drinking. So what are the normal effects of alcohol? Well, we get a pleasant feeling. We start to forget about our worries. Our thinking slows down. Good reason why we shouldn't drink and drive, because our reaction time is slower. Other thing we get is we get an increased confidence. There's a reduced social anxiety. It makes it easy to talk to other people. And there's actually an increased risk taking. I can actually take the chance and go and ask the girl to dance. Another good reason not to drink and drive, because not only is my thinking slowed down, but I'm more likely to take a risk on the road. Now, the thing about those things, those effects of alcohol, everyone who drinks gets them. Not just alcoholics, everyone gets them. That's what actually we're after. That's why it's such a popular drug. My problem is not that I get those effects. My problem is I get those effects plus an extra one. I get a craving to keep going and keep going. Once I start, I want to keep on going. This is an abnormal effect. It doesn't happen to most other people. So it only occurs in this small percentage of people, might suggest it, a large percentage of the people who end up in AA. Mm-hmm. When AA first was around and they wrote the book, there was this doctor that had treated a whole lot of those early AA members, but he'd been studying alcoholism for quite some time. And had really come up with this idea to describe alcoholism. And he wrote part of the book, the first chapter, well, the chapter before the first chapter is called The Doctor's Opinion. This is what he said about it.
We believe, and so suggested a few years ago, that the action of alcohol on these chronic alcoholics is a manifestation of an allergy. that the phenomenon of craving is limited to this class and never occurs in the average temperate drinker. These allergic types can never safely use alcohol in any form at all. And once having formed the habit and found they cannot break it, once having lost their self-confidence, their reliance upon things human, their problems pile up on them and become astonishingly difficult to solve.
So he's pointing out that, you know, the basis of alcoholism is a physical thing. When I drink it, I have a different physical reaction to other people. He described it as an allergy. What's an allergy? Well, an allergy, simply put, in his terms, is an abnormal reaction. These days, if you think about an allergy, you might think of strawberries. For most of us, we can eat strawberries, and strawberries and cream on pavlova is fantastic. But for a small percentage of people, they might have a food allergy. Throat tightens up and an itching and tingling in the mouth, maybe skin rashes. So this is an abnormal reaction, only occurs in a small percentage of people. With alcohol and me, it's not like that though. It's not that sort of anaphylactic reaction, but it is an abnormal reaction. With me and alcohol, the abnormal reaction I get is a craving to keep drinking. I feel uncomfortable if I can't keep drinking, and I'll do anything to get more alcohol. So that's the abnormal reaction that only occurs in a small percentage of people. Now, so because of this allergy, this abnormal reaction, I get this craving and I'm powerless after the first drink. After I've had that first drink, I don't know what's going to happen next, where I'm going to go, what I'm going to do, but I do know after I've had that first one, I'm going to want another one and another one after that. So how do I know if I'm powerless after the first drink? Well, this first step is all about honest reflection. I think back about the way that I drank, what happened when I drank, those times where I promised myself I wasn't going to get drunk, but I did anyway on the way to the wedding, you know, and the wife says to me, don't get drunk this time. And I go, no worries, I only have one or two. But once I get there, I start drinking and end up dancing on the table and insulting the bride's mother and making a mess of myself again. And even those times where I didn't have a drink, those times where I avoided that first drink because I knew there wasn't going to be enough, even those memories that I go, yeah, I've known this for a while. I can't control how much I drink once I start. So the first step is based on this honest reflection about the way that I drank and my inability to control it. If you're not sure, the AA program in the book is really practical. It actually has a suggestion.
We do not like to pronounce any individual as alcoholic, but you can quickly diagnose yourself. Step over to the nearest bar room and try some controlled drinking. Try to drink and stop abruptly. Try it more than once. It will not take long for you to decide if you're honest with yourself about it. It may be worth a bad case of jitters if you get a full knowledge of your condition.
So there's the suggestion. If you're not sure that your drinking's out of control, try controlled drinking. I might suggest, though, by the time, you know, most of us get to AA, now, we've already tried this over and over again. We wouldn't be coming to AA looking for help if we hadn't tried this. But the point about this first step is it's this self-diagnosis. I have to really understand what it is to be an alcoholic. And I certainly identified. By the time I got to AA, I didn't have to try it again. I'd had this experience over and over again for many, many years, knowing that once I started, it went out of control. There was always those times, though, you know, there's one or two nights where, you know, I'd have a couple of drinks and I'd actually really fight through it and I'd stop at one or two. And I always remember those in the back of my mind. You know? Remember that time back in November where I only had one or two? See, I'm not an alcoholic. But then my problem was I could never predict which nights I could and which nights I couldn't.
Yeah.
But really, in the end, I had to admit, yeah, that's me. I can't control how much I drink or predict it, you know, once I've started. So because of the craving, we get drunk. Again and again and again, certainly a lot more than other people do. And there are consequences to me being drunk all the time. This is what the book talks about.
We alcoholics are men and women who have lost the ability to control their drinking. We know that no real alcoholic ever recovers control. All of us felt at times that we were gaining control, but such intervals, usually brief, were inevitably followed by still less control, which led in time to pitiful and incomprehensible demoralisation. We are convinced to a man that alcoholics of our type are in the grip of a progressive illness. Over any considerable period, we get worse, never better.
And so I start drinking more and more, I'm getting drunk more and more, And then I start lying about my drinking. One of the first symptoms of alcoholism is I start lying to other people and to myself about how much I'm drinking and about how it's out of control. I start hiding bottles. I start hiding empties. I know why I'm hiding the bottles, so that, you know, my wife doesn't find them and tip them out. Why am I hiding the empties? Because I'm ashamed of the amount I've drunk. I want to keep this a secret. I start covering up. I start sneaking drinks. I start neglecting my responsibilities. I start breaking promises to other people. I'm making promise to myself. You know, I'm not going to get drunk this time, and I do anyway. And breaking promises to other people. I start behaving badly because I'm just drunk a lot of the time. I'm blacking out. I'm passing out. I start becoming more and more selfish. You know, I don't think by nature I'm a selfish, dishonest person. But once alcohol's got control, I start becoming more and more selfish, and I have to lie more and cover it up. And then I start isolating because I'm ashamed of the way that I drink. And then it turns into this physical dependency on alcohol as well. And then on top of that, I start getting these life problems. I start getting family problems. I'm getting employment problems because I'm not showing up to work, or I'm hungover all the time. I'm getting social problems. People don't want to know me if I'm drunk all the time. I'm getting financial problems because I'm wasting all my money on alcohol. I'm getting relationships problems because I'm lying and covering up and breaking promises. I'm getting health problems that's starting to affect my health in all sorts of ways. And I'm possibly getting legal problems. If I'm drink driving, it depends on what other sorts of substances I might be taking. And what happens to an alcoholic like me? I look at my life and all those problems building up and building up and building up, and I come up with this really bright idea that these problems are caused because my drinking's out of control. I have this bright idea, I'll give up drinking. And for someone like me, this is a really smart idea. In fact, it's a very sane idea. If every time I start drinking, it tends to go out of control, the smart thing to do, the sane thing to do, is don't pick up the first drink. If I can put the drink down, then I can set about fixing up all those other problems caused by my drinking. I know I'm powerless after the first drink, so I've decided to stop drinking. That's it, no more, I'm going to stop. And so I stop. What happens then? Well, I then immediately go into withdrawal because of the physical dependency that's built up. And that's not very pleasant. One of the reasons I hesitate to stop is because I know if I suddenly stop, once I've been drinking for a long time and a lot, it's going to be really uncomfortable. In fact, in some cases, quite dangerous to stop. And there's that withdrawal, the anxiety and nausea and insomnia, and there's mood swings, and I'm restless and I'm irritable and I'm discontent. And at the same time, I don't want to drink, but there's that thought that keeps on coming back. I know how to get rid of that you know, uncomfortable thing. If I have another drink, it'll take that away. So not only am I withdrawing, but I'm constantly thinking about drinking. And it's a really tough time to get through.
It's relentless.
This is what Silkworth said about it.
Of course, an alcoholic ought to be freed from his physical craving for liquor, and this often requires a definite hospital procedure before psychological measures can be of maximum benefit.
So my first problem is a medical one. I have to get through this withdrawal phase. So I do that. I get medical advice. Maybe I need to change my environment, go and stay with an auntie or someone with no grog around, or even go in and get a medical detox. But I need to do that to get through the medical problem, that initial medical problem of withdrawal. And it's tough. It's really, really hard to do. But the good news is it doesn't take very long. 7 to 10 days, depending on how much I've been drinking for how long. I know what this is like because I did it many times. I'd stop drinking and I'd fight my way through it, get that medical help. And after a week, a few good meals, and a vitamin B injection, and a couple of nights sleep, and I'm feeling much better. And after a week, I'm raring to go. I'm going to fix up my life now that I've stopped that drinking. Now, the next question is, can I stay stopped? Now, we're going to have a look at a story in the AA book. Now, the way the book's structured is the first 160-odd pages describe the AA program and the 12 steps. And then the back half of the book is a whole lot of personal stories of alcoholism and recovery. Jim's story is not one of the stories in the back of the book. The stories in the back of the book get changed. Each time a new edition of the book comes out, they take out some of the stories and put in new ones. But Jim's story is in the front part of the book because it's a prime example of alcoholism, and it's always been in the book. So this is what it says about Jim.
Our first example is a friend we shall call Jim. This man has a charming wife and family. He inherited a lucrative automobile agency. He had a commendable World War record. He's a good salesman. Everybody likes him. He's an intelligent man, normal so far as we can see, except for a nervous disposition. He did no drinking until he was 35. In a few years, he became so violent when intoxicated that he had to be committed. On leaving the asylum, he came into contact with us. We told him what we knew of alcoholism and the answer we had found. He made a beginning. His family was reassembled and he began to work as a salesman for the business he'd lost through drinking. All went well for a time, but he failed to enlarge his spiritual life. To his consternation, he found himself drunk half a dozen times in rapid succession. On each of these occasions, we worked with him, reviewing carefully what had happened. He agreed he was a real alcoholic and in a serious condition. He knew he faced another trip to the asylum if he kept on. Moreover, he would lose his family, for whom he had a deep affection.
So there's Jim. What do we know about Jim? He's a car salesman. He's respected. He's good at his job. He's well-liked. He's intelligent. He didn't start drinking until he was 35. You know, it doesn't sound like an alcoholic, but he is. And when he started drinking, it quickly went out of control. We know that Jim wants to stop drinking. We know that because he's actually seeking treatment. He's gone into an asylum to try and stop drinking. He knows about alcoholism. It's been explained to him, particularly the aspect about the craving. So he's identified with that. He's admitted that he's a real alcoholic. This shows that Jim has actually taken the first step. Jim has admitted that he's a real alcoholic. It shows that the first step on its own doesn't stop us drinking. If the first step stopped us drinking, we wouldn't need the other 11. And he knows about the consequences. He knows that if he starts drinking again, it'll go out of control. He'll end up hurting his family again. But he got drunk again. Now, the next part of the story, he's come out of the asylum. He's had a few little relapses, but now he's stayed sober for quite a while. And he's got another job selling cars. This particular day, he goes out looking for someone to sell a car to. And he stops at a roadside cafe to have lunch. He says in his story, no thought of drinking, no thought of drinking. He orders a sandwich for lunch, still no thought of drinking. He then decides to have a glass of milk with his sandwich, still no thought of drinking. And this is what he said happened next.
Suddenly, the thought crossed my mind that if I were to put an ounce of whiskey in my milk, it couldn't hurt me on a full stomach. I ordered a whiskey and poured it into the milk. I vaguely sensed I was not being any too smart, but felt reassured as I was taking the whiskey on a full stomach. The experiment went so well that I ordered another whiskey and poured it into more milk. That didn't seem to bother me, so I tried another.
So what happened to Jim? He's sitting there having lunch, you know, that sandwich and a glass of milk, and this thought pops into his head, if I put an ounce of whiskey in my milk, it won't hurt. He said there was this vague feeling, just a vague feeling, maybe this is not a good idea. Notice it didn't come rushing back to him. I'm an alcoholic. If I start drinking, it'll go out of control and I'll hurt my family. None of that came to mind, just this vague feeling, maybe not a good idea. And the very next thought is, it'll be okay on a full stomach. And he picks up the drink. It does go out of control and ends up back in that asylum again. So this is what the book says about that sort of thinking.
He had much knowledge about himself as an alcoholic, yet all reasons for not drinking were easily pushed aside in favour of the foolish idea that he could take whiskey if only he mixed it with milk. Whatever the precise definition of the word may be, we call this plain insanity.
So this is the insanity of the first step. He's fully aware that he's an alcoholic. He's been hospitalised for it before. He doesn't want to drink, but he went ahead and did it anyway. That's the crazy thing about this. And this word insanity keeps on coming up over and over again in the big book when it talks about these relapses. Talking about insanity, I want to talk about this place. This is St. Vincent's Hospital here in Melbourne. Up on the third floor of that particular building used to be the psych ward. It was St. Dimpner's ward, which is St. Dimpner's the patron saint of insanity for some reason. And I was there about 31 years ago. I was there because I wanted to stop drinking. I'd done one detox before that, stayed sober for a while, and then relapsed. And my doctor, wanted to put me into hospital. There weren't any 28-day rehabs, and so this was the treatment that was available to me at the time. I was there voluntarily. I wasn't committed or anything. I was there because I really wanted to stop drinking. And I'd been there for a couple of weeks and doing everything I was told and all of those things, and they trusted me. They knew I didn't want to drink, but they let me out for half a day. I had to catch the train from the city out to the suburban Ivanhoe where I lived to sign a new lease on the flat that I had. And so they let me out. I went to the real estate agent, signed the new lease, went to the flat, checked the mail, made sure someone had been feeding the cat, and then went back to the railway station to catch the train back into the city and go back into hospital. When I got to the railway station, crossing over the railway footbridge, there was a train there, and as I crossed over the bridge, the train pulled out and I missed this train by about 30 seconds. Now, across the road from the Ivanhoe railway station is the Ivanhoe Hotel. So I walked across the road into the bar, sat down and had a drink, much to my amazement. Now, I was there for some hours after that, because once I'd started, I wanted to keep on drinking. But then I started to feel guilty and thinking, gee, I shouldn't be here. I'm meant to be in hospital being treated for alcoholism. And some people I knew came into the bar, and I felt embarrassed because I still had the hospital tag on my wrist and I didn't want them to know. And I actually went and caught a much later train back into town, back to the hospital. When I got there, it happened my doctor was still there. She normally wasn't there at that time of day, but she smelt the grog on my breath and she said to me, "Have you been drinking?" And I said, "No. You know, here's someone I've been trying to be honest with every day." And I had a few drinks. And the first thing I do is start lying to people. And I lied to her. I said, "No, I haven't had a drink." But she said, "Look, I can smell it on you." And she took me aside. I can remember this really clearly. Put me into this little consulting room and sat me down. And she asked me this question. She said, "What made you decide to have a drink?" And I didn't understand the question because I hadn't made a decision. I didn't stand on that railway footbridge and say to myself, "Look, I've just missed that train by 30 seconds. I now have a choice. I can go and sit on the platform and wait just 19 minutes for another train, or I can go across the road and have a drink and then weigh up the pros and cons and what will happen if I do that and what in the circumstances." Mm. None of that came to mind. I missed the train by 30 seconds. I walked across the road and had a drink. And that really scared me that was possible. Here I was in treatment for alcoholism and I found myself drinking with no sane explanation at all. So this is where I find out about the second problem when I come to AA, the second problem. The first problem is to do with the craving. The second problem is these thoughts of drinking that keep returning. In AA, we refer to it as an obsession with drinking. But really, the really big problem is the insanity. Not just the thoughts that keep on coming up, but the insanity of actually acting on them. And because of that insanity, those insane moments where I actually act on it and pick up a drink, I'm powerless before the first drink. What would happen? I'd decide to stop, I'd do a detox, I'd stop for a period of time, life would tend to get better, but that thought, that obsession would still be there. The thought would keep coming back, and I'd resist it, and using all my willpower, the most powerful thing I have, I use my willpower, I'm not going to drink, and now I have this knowledge that I'm an alcoholic and I shouldn't drink, so I use that, and then there's the fear of what will happen if I start drinking again. These are really powerful tools to stop me drinking. So I would resist it, and then one day I'd have a different thought. I'd think, but this time it'll be different. Or I think, I haven't had a drink for 3 months, so I must be okay to drink now. I fall for that thing. We tell ourselves, if I can go without a drink for a long time, the next time I drink, that craving thing won't happen. Or I start thinking, last time wasn't that bad. I was in hospital for a week. My wife almost left me. I almost lost my job. But things weren't so bad that I need to quit altogether. But in any of those types of thoughts are this denial. I just forget about how bad things were. And I pick up the drink again. There's that insanity of picking up again. Or perhaps I stop drinking for a while and I get sober and that thought's there in my head to have a drink. And I know I shouldn't. It's not denial, but I come up with some excuse because I can't cope with life without a drink because I'm nervous about something or I'm angry at someone or I'm worried or I'm sad or I'm jealous of the people who can drink. And even though I know I shouldn't, somehow I come up with an excuse. And the Big Book talks about any of those excuses as being insanely insufficient compared to the suffering that I know is going to happen if I start drinking again. There's that insanity again. Or perhaps I have this argument in my head. There's that thought to have a drink and I start this argument. Yes, I will. Yes, no, I won't. Yes, I will. No, I won't. That argument might go on for some days, sometimes only hours, sometimes only minutes. But I know in the end when that argument was going on in my head, I eventually always gave into it. I lost the argument. It says in the Big Book, the insane idea won out. And I'd pick up a drink again. Once again, there's that insanity. And then there were these other times where I'd be sober for a while, I'd have that thought pop into my head to have a drink, and there'd be no second thought. No thought, no excuse, no resistance. I'd just go ahead and do it. And this is the bit that really scared me the most. With that denial, I can come to AA and really understand about me being an alcoholic. You know, I get past that denial. I really accept that I am an alcoholic. And with those excuses, I come to a bunch of AA meetings, and occasionally when I hear someone coming back from a relapse and I listen to their story and I listen to the excuses they had about why they picked up, and when I hear about what happened to them afterwards, I realize how ridiculous those excuses were compared to what happened after they picked up. And with that argument in my head, I think with a bit more strategies, a bit more willpower, I'll be able to win that argument. I'll do something different. I'll ring someone up. I'll go to another meeting. I think I can win that argument. But how do I combat against this, where the thought just pops into my head and I just go ahead and do it? But this has happened to me more than once, and it's a scary place to be. And it's really about powerlessness and the insanity of picking up again. So how do I know if I'm powerless before the first drink? Well, once again, it's about honest reflection. I think back about the way that I drank, but in this case, more about those times when I really wanted to stop and couldn't bring myself to do it. Or those times where I did stop for a day or a week or a month or longer and went back and picked up again. If you're not sure, again, it's a really practical program. There's a suggestion in the book. This is what it says.
If anyone questions whether he has entered this dangerous area, let him try leaving liquor alone for 1 year. If he's a real alcoholic and very far advanced, there is scant chance of success. In the early days of our drinking, we occasionally remain sober for a year or more, becoming serious drinkers again later. Though you may be able to stop for a considerable period, you may yet be a potential alcoholic. We think few to whom this book will appeal can stay dry anything like a year. Some will be drunk the day after making their resolutions, most of them within a few weeks.
So there's a suggestion. If you're not sure you're powerless, just stop drinking. Make the decision, don't drink anymore. Now, if I could have done that, I'd now be 32 years sober. All it would have taken was one detox, and then I'd become someone who doesn't drink. And I wouldn't be calling myself an alcoholic, and I wouldn't be going to AA. I would just be someone who quit. My problem was that I couldn't quit and stay stopped. Some will be drunk the next day. There were times where I'd come out of a detox and pick up straight away. Other times, it might take a bit longer, but it really wasn't very long. It was days and weeks before I would pick up again. There's the real evidence that I'm powerless over alcohol. What happens with this? Well, there's this obsession. That thought to have a drink keeps on coming back and coming back, and I resist it and I resist it. And then one day, the denial comes back, or I come up with some excuse, or I lose the argument, or there's just no thought of the consequences. There's that insanity, and I pick up the drink. When I pick up the drink, the craving kicks in, and it quickly goes out of control, and my life falls apart. All those problems come rushing back into my life, and all that relationship problems, and the health problems, and the money problems. And so once again, I make a decision to stop. And I get help to do that if I need that to get through the detox phase of it, but I stop drinking. And whenever I stop drinking, life gets better because I'm showing up to work on time, I'm not lying and covering up, more money in my pocket, my health's improving. Life gets better But at the same time, there's that obsession, that thought still there, that urge, that memory, and it keeps on coming back and coming back, and I resist it. And then one day, there's that insanity. I've got no defense. I pick up the drink, the craving kicks in, goes out of control, life turns bad, and then I stop again, and life gets better when I stop. But the obsession's still there, and I do the insane thing, and I pick it up, and round and round and round we go. And the cycle turns into a downward spiral, and down we go. And in the end, even when I do stop drinking, those periods where I stop drinking, life doesn't tend to get any better because I've lost everything. I've lost the job. My wife has left. My health is really failing. I've lost self-respect. It's all fallen apart. That's the alcoholic cycle. And I really, really identify with that. I'm going to have a look at another story. The thing about that cycle, though, I went through it over and over. If you read the big book, the first chapter is Bill Wilson's story. He goes through that cycle over and over again. But I want to let you know you don't have to go through it anymore. So Fred's story in the book, also in the front part of the book, is really important. Fred is a partner in an accounting firm. So he's a smart guy. He's described as having an attractive personality, makes friends with everyone, a good income, happily married, is stable, well-balanced, and has good judgment in every respect, except one thing, when it comes to alcohol. He's an alcoholic. When he starts drinking, it goes out of control. And his life starts to turn bad, and he ends up in hospital for the first time. When he's in hospital, he meets some people from AA, and they tell him about the disease. And he says, well, I've got no excuse for drinking. I've got no reason to drink the way that I do, but I recognize the craving that happens when I drink. So I'm going to stop. He makes this commitment not to drink again. And he says to them, understand what you're talking about, but I've got a strong will, and I'm able to solve other problems in my life with my strong will. I get what you're saying, and I'm not going to drink anymore. And so that's what he does. And he stays sober by himself for a while. And then he's sober a couple of months and back at work. Things are going really well. He then has to fly from New York, where he lived, to Washington to give a presentation for a government department. Part of his job as an accountant. And he flies to Washington. And this is how he describes the day.
Physically, I felt fine. Neither did I have any pressing problems or worries. My business came off well. I was pleased and knew my partners would be too. It was the end of a perfect day, not a cloud on the horizon.
So, Fred's having a great day. He's past the physical withdrawal and the restless, irritable phase, all of that. Life is getting better. He's back at work. End of a perfect day, not a worry in the world, not a cloud on the horizon. And this is what happened next.
I went to my hotel and leisurely dressed for dinner. As I crossed the threshold of the dining room, the thought came to mind that it would be nice to have a couple of cocktails with dinner. That was all, nothing more. I ordered a cocktail and my meal. Then I ordered another cocktail. After dinner, I decided to take a walk. When I returned to the hotel, it struck me a highball would be fine before going to bed. So I stepped into the bar and had one. I remember having several more that night and plenty next morning. I have a shadowy recollection of being in an airplane bound for New York and of finding a friendly taxicab driver at the landing field instead of my wife. The driver escorted me about for several days. I know little of where I went or what I said and did. Then came the hospital with unbearable mental and physical suffering. As soon as I regained my ability to think, I went carefully over that evening in Washington. Not only had I been off guard, I'd made no fight whatever against the first drink. This time, I had not thought of the consequences at all.
So Fred's done a lot of crazy things there. He's gone missing for 3 days, doesn't even know what he did. But of course he did those things because he was intoxicated. The really insane thing he did is when he was stone cold sober. He had the thought to have a drink and he went ahead and did it. He's even worse than Jim. He says, not only had I been off guard, I'd made no fight whatever against the first drink. I'd not thought of the consequences at all. At least Jim had a vague feeling, maybe not a good idea. This guy's had none of that. Now, some people who've not experienced this, our families and people around us, and they see us stop drinking and then relapse, and they seem to think, oh, they must have had a really uncontrollable urge, you know, a powerful urge to force them to drink. But that's not what happened to Fred here. He didn't get an uncontrollable urge to drink. He just had this thought that crossed his mind. And the problem was he forgot about what the consequences would be. There's that insanity. After that, this is what he said.
I now remembered what my alcoholic friends had told me, how they prophesied that if I had an alcoholic mind, the time and place would come, I would drink again. They had said that though I did raise a defence, it would one day give way before some trivial reason for having a drink. Well, just that did happen and more, for what I had learned of alcoholism did not occur to me at all. I knew from that moment that I had an alcoholic mind. I saw that willpower and self-knowledge would not help in those strange mental blank spots. I had never been able to understand people who said that a problem had been hopelessly defeated. I knew then it was a crushing blow.
So this is Fred taking the first step. Before this happened to him, you know, he wasn't sure that he was powerless over alcohol. He knew about the craving side of it, but this is Fred actually realizing, admitting that he has this alcoholic mind. And as he says, it's a crushing blow. The first step isn't a nice place to be. It's described here as a crushing blow to actually realize your own powerlessness. I'll tell you another story. This is like 3 years after that psych hospital. I'd done a number of detoxes, and each time I would do that, I'd come out of a detox and put my life back together, get another job, life would get better, and then I'd relapse again. By this point, I'd gone into a detox, I'd lost everything. I'd lost the flat in Ivanhoe, had nowhere to live, homeless, and my parents convinced my younger brother to let me stay at his place. And part of the rules, he said, if you're going to stay here, you're not allowed to drink. And I readily agreed with that because I didn't want to drink. And I got another job. I love the job. I'm making money. I'm getting things back on track. And I was sober quite a while. And then one day, it was a sunny day in Melbourne. I've got money in my pocket. It was a Thursday. I wasn't working that day, but I had to do some washing. And I thought, I'll do my brother a favor. So I'll do some of his washing as well. Great day. Life's getting better. I went down to the local laundromat, put two big loads of washing into the machine, and walked across the road and had a drink. Much to my amazement. Now, I remember a whole lot of things that happened in that pub that afternoon. I can remember some conversations and playing pool. Also, I remember thinking, gee, I shouldn't be drinking, but now that I've started, I might as well keep going. See, the craving had kicked in again. And I kept on drinking, didn't go and pick up the washing for another 2 days. Someone had put it in a cardboard box and was still there in the corner for some reason.
Smelly.
Yeah. And that was my last big bender. I tried to keep it secret from my brother, but I can't. Once I'd started, it was out of control, and eventually worked it out and kicked me out, took me up to Echuca, where my parents live, and I went into hospital. And from there, after the detox, I ended up in this longer term rehab, and that's where I was introduced to AA. I can remember being in a meeting in AA, absolutely defeated, and I heard someone read this out in the meeting.
The fact is that most alcoholics, for reasons yet obscure, have lost the power of choice in drink. Our so-called willpower becomes practically non-existent. We are unable at certain times to bring into our consciousness with sufficient force the memory of the suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago. We are without defence against the first drink.
That's me. That's what was happening to me. That just the inability to bring to mind the suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago. So the first step becomes this simple question. Am I powerless over alcohol? To take the first step is when I admit that to myself. I can break it down like this. Does my drinking go out of control once I start? Well, tick. I know that's true. Second question, so have I decided to stop? Have I made the sane decision to stop drinking? Well, I certainly made that decision. I was really seeking help. And the third question, have I kept picking up a drink despite my efforts to stop? Well, that was true as well. Now, the thing about those three questions, I could sit at a bar and go tick, 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 intellectually tick those boxes. But really, the first step is when it moves from up here down to here, and I really accept it. And I look at that and say, if that's true, I'm in deep, deep trouble.
Crushing blow.
If I'm powerless after the first drink because of the craving, and I'm powerless before the first drink because of the obsession and that insanity, then I'm powerless over alcohol and my life becomes unmanageable. And the first step is simply admitting that that's true. The first step is admitting to the insanity. The thing about the first step is there's no hope in the first step. The first step doesn't fix the problem. The hope comes in step two. So if I'm powerless over alcohol, step two suggests that we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. So step two is actually about sanity. It's the hope that I can recover, that I can be restored to sanity. So step one, as we saw, requires honesty, honest reflection about the way that I drank, what happened, and my inability to stop on my own. Whereas step two requires an open mind. If everything that I've tried has failed, I need an open mind, open enough to listen to what's working for other people, even if they're suggesting something really radical, like a spiritual 12-step program. So step one comes from desperation. It comes from desperation and suffering and repeated failure. I don't want to stay in step one. Whereas step two comes from inspiration. I come to AA and I meet people who've recovered. And I go, well, if it's working for them, maybe that can work for me. Step one is being honest about the problem, and step two is simply believing there's a solution. And the rest of the steps are about applying the spiritual solution that's been found to work for alcoholics. And that's what we'll be looking at over the next 5 weeks as we go through this series of workshops about the steps. The first step is acknowledging that insanity, acknowledging the problem. The second step, believing we can recover. And then there's a decision to go on with this spiritual program in step three. And then I have to get off my bum and do some work, taking inventory and sharing it with someone else, being willing to change and praying for help in step six and seven, and then looking for the harms I've done and making amends in steps eight and nine. And where I really want to get to is those last three, because in the book it says, by the time I get to those last three, sanity has been returned. Steps 10 and 11 become a daily program of some inventory and some prayer and meditation to stay connected to this power that I need to stay sober. And of course, step 12 is passing it on to the next person. Step 12 is the most powerful step of all, because that's what keeps me sober long term. So step one, a simple question we can each ask ourselves. Am I powerless over alcohol? Mm.
Thanks, David. And it's something that we need to reflect on ourselves and come to our own conclusion. And I did most of my drinking up in a really small town, sort of in between Melbourne and Mildura. And, well, I had three kids and then realised that my drinking was out of control after a couple of years. And so I had another child, believing that that was going to fix my drinking problem. And, of course, it didn't. It just escalated, if anything else. So I actually drank all the way through that pregnancy. And so I'd go to extreme measures to stop drinking. And because my life was falling apart, relationships were falling apart. I was really conscious that I was neglecting my children because I was drinking, and so I wasn't looking after them properly. I was losing jobs. It was just getting worse and worse. And so the husband left, and I thought, that's great. He was my problem. Now I can sort my life out. And I didn't. You know, I'd started to become more and more dependent on alcohol. And that was my thinking. I just got to keep drinking. And even those times when I thought all day I'm thinking I'm not going to drink. And I drive to the bottle shop on the way home. The car had a mind of its own. And so it'd just take me to the bottle shop. And of course I'd have to buy it. And I just couldn't get a handle on it. I had lots of willpower in other areas of my life. And I needed to. We struggled with finances and domestic violence and all those things that makes for a very unhappy home. And so I got to this point where my other two children were basically taken off me. And so I had my two oldest daughters with me, and I said to them, we need to leave this town. We're going to go to a different place. We're going to get a better life. And they said, we'll come too if you don't drink. And I convinced myself and I convinced them I wasn't going to drink anymore, ever. And I'd made these promises before, but this time I really meant it. And so we went to a bigger town. Things got better really quick. I was looking for a good job. I got a good job. The kids were going to school. They didn't like it very much, but it was not the dramas that we had been living. Our lives got better. And I can remember walking out and saying to the girls, I'm just going to get some bread and milk. I'll be back. And I can't even remember buying it. To this day, I still can't remember buying the alcohol, but I can still see myself coming through the back door with a cask of wine and the looks on their faces when I walked through to the kitchen and they said, you weren't going to do that anymore. You said, you promised you weren't going to do that anymore. And I said, oh, you just don't understand, because I didn't understand. I couldn't give him a reason why I drank, because I didn't know the reason why I was going to drink again. And so if there was any harmony in that place, it was gone within minutes, because Wendy's in the corner, she's crying, she's rocking, and Melissa's shouting and screaming and calling me a hypocrite and a liar. And I'm just, you know. So until it was another 9 months before I came into AA and got sober. And there was so much upheaval and hurt and more hurt that I had done, and more deceiving. People that I loved, I kept deceiving. And so they're the reasons why I came to AA. These are reasons why I wanted to stop drinking, is because I'm so sick of hurting everybody. And I'm so sick of the dishonesty and the pain that it's caused and the suffering. I remember pulling all the blinds down and just having everything in darkness, because I didn't want to see the world. I didn't want to be part of the world. And then there's this moment of clarity where I know that there's hope. And it's a really hard decision. Do I go to AA and stop drinking because I've met people who are sober and they're doing it? They're getting on with life without alcohol? Or do I continue to drink and die an alcoholic death? And it was a really hard decision, because alcohol screws up my thinking. The amount of alcohol that we consume, it has to have an effect on the brain and my actions and my thoughts. And so I need to get help. And it was that moment of surrender and walking to an AA meeting and thinking, fuck, this is the end of my life. It was a crushing blow. You know, I didn't come in singing. But that's where I got the hope. And that's where I saw and met people who had recovered from this deadly, deadly stinking disease. So next week we're going to be talking more about the hope, step two and step three, because that's what I've got to grab hold of. I can't sit in step one, because I sat in it for a long time and it nearly killed me. This is about life and death. And so we need to find a new life. This has saved my life and it's changed my life. And this is why we do this, because if you get something out of it, that's great. But this keeps us sober. Being able to share our experience and our story and keep giving people hope, because it keeps us in a hopeful state of mind.
Thanks so much, Chris. We'll finish with the Serenity Prayer.
God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference.